I just want to give you some numbers that the Lord used us to bless people this last year. Last year, we fed on our Wednesday nights the total of 2,155 people. Wow. You got to pray for Mary. She did a lot of cooking for a lot of people. And then our food pantry helped 374 people. So that's a blessing. So, I wanted to do something different on Family Sundays, but I just didn't have the time to put all things together for this Sunday. So, and it's, the beginning of a new year and everything. So I wanted to preach a message on the kingdom of God this morning. And, we can make all kinds. I quit making New Year's resolutions a long time ago because they don't last, It's just you're turning up the willpower screws. I'm going to fast, I'm going to lose weight, and, it lasts for about a week or so, Or I'm not going to get mad anymore, and, that lasts a day. So, what I do is I do faith. I attack things by faith, things that I want to see happen this next year, I believe God for. And I think you'll see better results that way. So you do faith resolutions instead of, willpower resolutions. So this morning we're going to talk about the kingdom of God. And, the kingdom of God is a mystery, but Jesus talked about it 86 times in the New Testament. And so there's a lot in here about the kingdom of God, and it's important. I think understanding that you are part of a kingdom, it transcends your idea of Christianity to a deeper level. Sometimes we just see ourselves as, we go to Hope Church and 30 Triangle Drive, and but you're part of something bigger than that. You're part of something that Jesus came preaching right out of the gate, preaching. He says that the gospel, he was preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. And so what is the kingdom of God, and how do we function in it, and where is it at? And we're going to look at that this morning. So I want to look at the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6, 5 through 13. And I don't know if you could read that, but if you look at this, read this along in your Bibles with me, because this is powerful. And when you pray, that's presupposing that you will pray. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogue and in the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say unto you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, Jesus is saying, when you pray, go into your closet and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. Go in there, and you've got a relationship with God, and just connect with the Holy Spirit when you pray. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. I think the King James Version says they're vain repetitions. And as the Gentiles do, for if they think that they will be heard for their many words, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So you say, why do I need to ask him? Because he wants you to ask him. And pray like this. I love this. He's not saying, this is an outline for prayer. He says, I want you to pray like this. Our Father which is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. See, I believe, and I grew up saying this prayer repetitiously, over and over and over and over again. You know, how many have done that before? And so I've done that, but I think what this is Jesus was giving us an outline or some guidelines how to pray. And the first one is recognizing God's authority. If you could put up the next slide, Carol. Recognizing God's authority. Our Father, He's your Father. Isn't that awesome? How many in here is God your Father? Well, do you know who your Father is? He created the universe. He spoke everything into existence. He said, "Let there be light," and there was light. He hung the stars and created the oceans and the mountains and the valleys and all that. That's your Father. He's also is a God of love and mercy and he's all knowing, all forgiving, but he's caring, but he also has wrath and everything, and he is our Father. He's our Father. So when you pray, don't just storm in there. You go in there with reverence and you say, "Our Father." Recognizing that He is the supreme authority of all things. He upholds all things by the word of His power. Everything is held together by the word of His power. So you go in and you pray and you say, "Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Holy is your name, Lord God." And the word holy means set apart. He's holy others. He's totally different from the human race. Hallowed be thy name. He's holy other. And when we go into the throne room of grace, we go in and recognizing His authority and His holiness. That song we sang, "He is sovereign over us." That means that He is Lord over us. He's the King over us. He's sovereign over us. A.W. Tozier said that the greatest responsibility that rests on the church today, and he said this 30 or 40 years ago, he said, is that we once come back to the reverence and recognizing the holiness of God in our presence. And the Bible says when there's ever two or more that gather in my name, what happens? He's there in the midst of us. The very presence of God is in this room this morning, our Father. Hallowed be thy name. And then you pray, "Your kingdom come." Your kingdom come, and your will be done. See, if He is the King and we're in His kingdom, His will should be done. Not our will, but His will. Because He's sovereign, He's a King. And so, your kingdom come, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And I thought about that one time, and I thought, well, what's he mean by that, you know, on earth as it is in heaven? Well, you know, I think God's will is being done in heaven. I mean, the angels have a will, but they do God's will because they're right there in his presence, and the streets are paved with gold, and they know they got it made, you know. They do the will of God on earth. In the presence of God, they don't vote about things in heaven, you know, because God is king, and so they just simply submit to his will in his presence. But let's take it down on earth. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on heaven as it is in earth. Well, you know, we live in a democratic society, and so we think we got our choices about everything. But if you're in God's kingdom, his will needs to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Say amen or oh me. His will to be done. I don't get a chance to vote about it. You know, I mean, I might complain about it for a month or 2 months or a year. But eventually, I need to submit to his will. I won't get peace in my heart and my spirit until I say, okay, God, I submit to your will. God's not going to submit to your will. We have to submit to his will. And then, after you've done that, then you bring your requests to God. He says, give us our day, our daily bread. Make your requests known unto God. And then, he says in verse 4, the fourth thing, and you know what? He just slips this in there. When you pray, this element needs to be in the prayer, in your prayers. Forgive us our debts. I may have some debts. So, you know, we go to God, Lord, forgive me. But he says, oh no, I want you to be forgiven as you forgive. I mean, I'd like to rip that out of the Bible. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. It's a kingdom of God principle. It's not a worldly principle because, you know, the world says if somebody messes with you, get back at them. You know, do everything you can to hurt them and make them pay. But a kingdom principle says forgive those debts or forgive that person as I have forgiven you. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And I want you to read this because it's very important. Look at Matthew 18, 21 through 35. And this is a good way to start off your new year. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him unto seven times? Now the Jewish elders and the leaders back then, they said, if you would forgive somebody three times, that's plenty. Everybody says, yeah, man, that sounds good. So Peter was saying, he's going to be generous. And so he says, I know the law and the elders, and they say three times, but Lord, how about seven times? You know, I'm really spiritual. I'll forgive them seven times. And what did Jesus say? Jesus said unto, I say unto you, up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. How many is that? How much is that? 70 times seven? 490. 490. Wow. 490 times. Why do you think Jesus said that? I think by the time you got to the 489th time, it would be a way of life to you. You wouldn't even be counting. You knew that you have to forgive your other people's debts in order for God to forgive you yours. So he goes on to say, now listen to this, therefore the kingdom of heaven, and the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God is used interchangeable sometimes, and a lot of people believe that they're the same. Some don't, but he says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like. So the kingdom of heaven is like this. It's like a certain man who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he began to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Now, if that was silver, it's the total equivalent of $52,800,000. Think about that. If you had a debt, you may have mortgages. I mean, they're like maybe 20, 30, 40, 100,000. I couldn't sleep if I had a debt of $52 million. I couldn't pay it. Could you pay a debt for $52 million? Anybody in here could possibly even begin to work on that? But as he was not able to pay, his master commended that he be sold with his wife and his children and all that he had, and the payment to be made. And the servant, therefore, he knew he didn't have it within him to pay that debt. And he didn't want to see his wife and his children be sold and him go into slavery. And he fell down on his knees. That will bring you to your knees. He fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Oh, wait a while, I'm jumped ahead of the thing. He fell down before him saying, master, have patience with me and I will pay you all. Then the master of the servant, I love these three words. You need to underline them in your Bible. He was moved with compassion. You know, Paul and I were talking this morning, and sometimes you lose your compassion. How many have lost your compassion before? And you become hardened toward things. But Jesus was, he was moved with compassion. Every time he gets ready, if you look in the New Testament, right before he healed somebody, and it says, and he was moved with compassion. And that means that he felt and identified what they were feeling and going through. I mean, if you see a drug addict or, you know, and you were in that situation before and see them destroying their lives and their families and everything, and you know what's going on because you've been there before, you're going to move with compassion to help that person. If you see somebody who's, you know, bitter and hurt and you've been there before, you kind of move with compassion to help that person because you identify with their hurt. So the master of the servant was moved with compassion and released him and forgave him his debt. What if the bank called you up and said, Travis, this is U.S. Bank. and we're just calling you to let you know I'm going to forgive your debt. What would you do? Well, that's nice. I mean, I think Travis would be, hallelujah, glory to God, our debt is forgiven. We don't have any more mortgage payments, and I don't have to go to that bank anymore. Praise God, my debt is forgiven. But that servant that just got forgiven that $52 million debt, he went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, which is 44 measly dollars. 44 bucks, folks. He just got forgiven of $52 million. And you know, we have a debt we couldn't pay before we were saved. There's no way we could have paid for our sins. There's no way we could have got forgiven except for the blood of Jesus Christ. And when he hung on the cross and he died to forgive and to shed his blood for the covering of our sins, and he said, your debt is paid in full. You don't have to do any more good works. You don't have to do anything to earn your righteousness. I have imputed. I have given you my righteousness, and your debt has been forgiven. And you are in right standing, John, with the God who created the universe, our Father. So he went out and found this guy who owed him $44. And he laid hands on him. That doesn't mean, oh, let me pray for you. He laid hands on him by his throat and saying, pay me everything that you owe me. Isn't that crazy? $44. $52 million. Oh, Brother Joe, you don't know what that person has done to me, though. You don't know what that person has said about me. You don't know how that person has hurt me. Time and time again. In God's eyes, it's $44. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved. They were watching all this happen and said, man, this guy just threw this guy in prison for $44, and he was just forgiven of $52 million. So they ran back and they told the master what happened. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you have not had compassion? On your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you. And his master, listen to this, was angry and delivered him over to the tormentors until he should pay all that was due him, which would be never. A lot of times people who have unforgiveness in their hearts are tormented while that other person enjoys their life. They're living in torment. Years back, there was a man down on the hill, and he went to St. Ambrose school with this guy, And they hated each other for years, and this guy was up in their 70s. And one day the guy saw this guy that he had problems with and went over and shot and killed him. Can you imagine that man living all those years with that hatred and bitterness? Hatred and bitterness, unforgiveness is like a cancer. It'll destroy your life. It was so important, Jesus said, this should be included in your prayers. And then he says, as the master was angry and delivered him into the tormentors until that he should pay the debt was due him, so shall my heavenly Father also do to you if each of you from the heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. And Spurgeon said that the principle is clear. God has forgiven such a great debt that any debt owed to us is absolutely insignificant in comparison. No man can possibly offend me to the extent that my sins have offended God. The principle must be applied in the little things done to us, but also in the great things done unto us. Jesus said, when you pray, when you come to the Father, you recognize his authority, and you want to bring forth a petition, make sure that your heart is clean and you don't have any bitterness inside of you. And then the fifth thing, he says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. You know, we could pray that, Lord, deliver me from this hurt habit or hang up. Help me to overcome this, God. Give me your grace and your glory and the power to overcome this. You could attack things in your life by faith and through prayer. And you will see God do things, and you'll be able to overcome things as you pray that. Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil. Deliver me. So we're going to be looking at four things about the kingdom of God. What it is, where it is, and what part, and what is our part in it. And then how do we at Hope Church increase the kingdom of God? So what is the kingdom of God? When Jesus was preaching of the kingdom of God, the Pharisees were expecting a political overthrow of Rome, and they had some serious misunderstandings about the kingdom of God. They were under Roman dominion, and so they thought, well, here he's saying he's a king, he's going to deliver us from the bondage of being under the Romans. And look at what it says in Romans 14:17. For the kingdom of God is not meat or drink. It's not natural things. If you were able to really, if you grasp this, you'll understand that you are part of a kingdom that's not natural. It's invisible. But it actually is parallel to the kingdoms of this world. So the kingdom of God is not meat or drink, but it's righteousness. It's right standing with God. It's being at peace with God. And it's also having the joy of the Holy Ghost. The kingdom of God is not meat or drink, but it's righteousness. How many are in right standing with God this morning? Nobody? Oh, there's one. Oh, okay, now the hands are going up. See, God's washed us by his blood and we're cleansed and we have fellowship with him. We're in right standing with God. So you're in the kingdom of God. Hey, you're in. It's righteousness and peace. It's the peace of God. and its joy in the Holy Ghost. It's not a material realm. It's establishing and promoting his righteousness and his peace and his joy in the Holy Ghost. That's what the kingdom of God is. And in Matthew 9:35-38, it says, "And Jesus went about the cities and the villages, teaching in the synagogue and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with what? Wow. He saw the multitude, and he was moved with compassion on them. Aren't you glad that God had compassion on you? I mean, John, when he saw you, when you were in that state-funded hotel with the orange suit on, he saw you and he was moved with compassion. In a jail cell, he was moved with compassion for John. For all of us. So when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and they were scattered abroad as having a sheep with no shepherd. You know, when you see lost people, they don't have a shepherd. They're lost. They're trying to find something and find some meaning. They're all over the place. Jesus had compassion on them. You know, sometimes I lose my compassion with people who've just made a lot of dumb mistakes.
Amen, brother. Maybe go back to the beginning again.
But let's be honest here this morning. I mean, Jake, you've worked with drug addicts, and you see people make dumb decisions, and sometimes you lose your compassion. And I've been guilty of it, you know. But I don't think God wants us to lose our compassion for the lost. I think, you know, I don't know. And Paul and we were talking. You know, how far do you go with people? What do you, you know? I don't. We haven't come to the answer of that. But when Jesus came to John, he was moved with compassion, even though he was a mess. When he came into my life, I was a disaster, and he was moved with compassion, and he came upon me. Saved my life. So I think I've just got to say, Lord, I don't understand this. I don't know why people do what they do, but give me your compassion back. Amen. You know, I was thinking this the other day. I was listening to something on about abortion, how horrible it is, how they dismember the babies, and you know, I just felt God's compassion for those kids, for those babies that were being dismembered in the womb. But I had peace because I know that God has established something to help that, to actually save lives. And that's where you get joy unspeakable and full of glory, because You're involved in something that God had compassion on. And then he says this. He was moved with compassion because they fainted and were scattered abroad. And then he said unto the disciples, the harvest is truly plentiful. But what's it say, Paul?
The workers are few.
And that's what we're talking about?
That's right.
Yeah. And so, you know, the going calculation or whatever it is that 20% of the people in the church do 80% of the work. And so you got 20%. This Christmas, Hope Church turned 25 years old. So I've been doing this for 25 years. And there's a lot of you in here that have been doing it also for 25 years, some less, some more. And you just kind of get wore out sometimes.
Called old age.
Yeah. But the Bible doesn't say to get retired, it says to get refired. Huh?
Galatians 6:9.
What's it say?
Let us not grow weary in doing good, for in due season you will reap a harvest if you don't give up.
Glory to God. That's a good verse. That should have been in my notes. The harvest is plentiful. Man, there's people out there that are just in need. I get phone calls all week long, you know, help me with this and give me that. And, you know, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. I love what Diana does with the kids. She's just so involved with the kids, and, you know. And if we didn't have her in the school, it would be a big void, wouldn't it? And Elaine and Travis and everybody in here that labors in this church, I am so grateful for that, you know, because it's building the kingdom of God. And then he says, labors are few, but pray ye therefore, the Lord of the harvest will send forth laborers into the harvest. So the gospel of the kingdom of God, it's about restoring lives and destroying the works of the devil. How many hate the devil? How many hate the works of the devil? You know, I hear about people having drug overdoses and dying, and we've seen our fair share of that here. And I hate that. I hate that the devil has deceived people to the point where at 25 and 30 years old, they die of an overdose. Don't you hate that? So the gospel of the kingdom is about restoring lives and destroying the works of the devil. Jesus said, I've come to heal the brokenhearted and set the oppressed free. That's why I came. The kingdom of God, it's not a democratic, it's not democratic, but it's theocratic. It's not man-ruled, but it's God-ruled. It's a monarchy. It has a king, and his name is Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. He's sovereign over us. He's the king. The kingdom of God, where is it? The kingdom of God is a realm in which God is acknowledged and obeyed as sovereign. See, you do this not to please the church. You do that because you're serving a king, and he is Lord of lords and King of kings. So when the king says, you know, don't say that to so-and-so, you don't do it because you want his will to be done and not your own. So you submit to the king. And when you submit to the king, his will is being done, and you're establishing the authority and the kingdom of God on this earth. The kingdom of God is wherever the rule of God is manifested. It's where God's authority and purpose are manifested. We establish the kingdom of God whenever we obey his word, when we allow the word to change us, and by submitting ourselves to his authority, by the authority of the king's word, you are changed from glory to glory, and you are establishing his kingdom. And so you don't submit, if you don't submit to the king's word, you are rebelling to his authority and not establishing his kingdom. So Jesus is telling us to pray that the rule and the authority of the kingdom of God would be manifested in the hearts of mankind. The kingdom of God is not the church. The church is the model to the world what it's like to live under the king and his kingdom. When people see your life, how come you don't get mad? How come you have this peace? How come you don't worry about things? Because I serve the king, who's King of kings and Lord of lords. He says, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory, so I don't have to worry about that stuff. How come you're getting mad at so-and-so? Because, well, the king told me I need to forgive others as I have been forgiven. I think, wow, that's quite a kingdom. But the church has got to model the kingdom of God, what it's like to live under kingdom principles. I mean, if you had somebody from Alabama in here, you'd be able to tell it in a minute. How y'all doing? And the world should be able to tell somebody who's living under the king. So what is our part in the kingdom of God? Isaiah 9:7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. I love that. Do you know that there's people outside these doors that are waiting to come into the kingdom of God? They just need to be invited. Well, Pastor Joe, you need to get out there and invite them. That's a whole nother message in itself. You know, this is an awesome church. We've got everything you need to be strong in the Lord. We've got a great Bible study on Wednesday nights. How many have ever have been to our Bible study on Wednesday night? You need to come. I guarantee you, money back guarantee, if you came on Wednesday nights, you'd love it. I'd love it. I'd love to come. I just get encouraged and built up, even though I'm not leading it. I just love it. And, you know, so that's making disciples. We've got Carly with Children's Church, and she's teaching the next generation about the kingdom of God. She's not babysitting our kids. She's teaching the next generation about God's kingdom. So we've got all kinds of things in place. We might not have all the bells and the whistles and the lights and the, you know, and all kinds of different programs and things to draw people in, but we've got the basics, fundamentals to get people saved and disciples and to grow in the Lord. So I would invite them in. I went out, me and Leroy went out the other day, and we went handing out flyers and knocking on doors, and we were just inviting people in. Some of them came, some of them didn't. But our part is to increase the government of God. You know, the Roman Empire at one time ruled most of the known world. It had 100 million inhabitants. How'd you like to be mayor of Rome? 100 million problems. Under the Pax Roma, which means peace of Rome. One way they did this is through Romanization. They would spread the Roman culture into the cities they took over. Today, the church, the culture is influencing the church instead of the church influencing the culture. How do we increase his government? By doing what it says in Matthew 6:33, seek second. Oh, what? First. Say first what? The kingdom of God, his righteousness. And then what happens? All these things will be added unto you. Don't seek everything else first. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything will be added unto you. Sometimes we seek other things first, and God gets what's left over. He gets our what's left over of our time, what's left over of our finances, you know. But if you want to get things in kingdom principle, you seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. The problem is we try and fix things in our own strength without seeking God first. How's that working for you? A lot of energy and time and nothing happening. I like this. I'll just close in this, and then we'll have communion. We'll have communion if I can get the ushers to come up and start on that. But, you know, Jesus said, he was talking about, he had a great supper planned out. And he said, go invite all my servants to come into this large supper that I've prepared. The servants went out and invited people and says, oh, I can't. I just married a wife, and I pray have me excused. Another one said, I just bought this piece of ground and I can't make it. I pray have me excused. So the servant went back and told the master what was going on. And he said, go out to the highways and byways and invite the lame, the blind, and the maimed and the poor into my house. Go out to the highways and the hedges, and it says, compel them to come in. Compel them. Now, that word means to compel. It means to, you know, kind of not just invite, but compel. Compel them to come in. So this morning, I just wanted to introduce you to the kingdom of God. I mean, it's something we don't think about it, but it's something that we're very much a part of if we're a Christian here today. You're part of God's kingdom, and you do his will because he is sovereign over us, because he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So this morning, Travis, can you play something? Maybe Amazing Grace or something would be cool. I want us to take a moment and let the Holy Spirit search your heart. Maybe there's somebody in your heart, in your world, that you haven't forgiven. you've kind of just put it in the background and just went on about your life, but it still hangs on there. And that hurt is still there. God wants to set you free from that this morning. And God's grace is what causes us and gives us the power to forgive. Even though it's a deep hurt and a deep wound, if you take the first step and say, okay, God, I choose to forgive that person, and I ask your blood to cleanse me from that bitterness, God will do that this morning. It doesn't mean what they did to you is right. It just means that you don't want to live in bondage to that hurt and that torment. So just take a moment, let the Holy Spirit bring that to your mind. And then after you've done that, after you've repented of that, just go ahead and take the elements.